Topic for this session is known as interrupt. Inside a computer, each and every operation is getting guided by an interrupt. If you press a key on a keyboard, an interrupt is getting generated. Do you want to see something on the screen? An interrupt is getting generated. Do you want to make your cursor blinking? An interrupt is getting generated. Do you want to change the shape of your cursor? Interrupt is getting generated. To do a printing, clicking on a mouse, moving the mouse, each and every operation is getting guided or getting controlled by an interrupt. So what is an interrupt? Let us suppose a program consists of multiple instructions. Whenever a program executes, then instructions are getting executed. The time required to execute one instruction is known as instruction cycle. When the CPU is executing program, then interrupts may get generated. Interrupts will be generated by the interrupt controllers. So these interrupts will be coming or input to the CPU. Whenever one instruction, after completion of one instruction cycle, the CPU will check whether any interrupt is pending or not. If any interrupt is not pending, then CPU will continue with the next instruction for execution. But if there is some interrupt is there, pending means it has not got service yet, then interrupt will be serviced and CPU will pay attention to that. And the current program which was in execution will be in the suspended mode. And its corresponding register save area and the state of the program will be saved. And the control will be going to the process to initiate the interrupt handling. The CPU will detect what kind of interrupt it has been produced and what is the respective interrupt number. There is a particular table residing in the memory known as IVT. The full form of IVT is interrupt vector table. Depending upon the interrupt number, one of the locations to which the program control or the CPU control will be directed in the interrupt vector table. Say if interrupt number 1, as an example, say interrupt number 1 has got generated, the control will be going to the say 20th location of the interrupt vector. If interrupt number 2 has got generated, then control will be going to the 24th location of the interrupt vector. I am giving using these values arbitrarily. So now what will happen? In that very particular interrupt vector table, there will be one jump or go to instruction with the help of which the control will be going to the respective interrupt handler program. That means the program which will give the necessity, which will give the necessary service to the interrupt generated. After execution of the interrupt handler program, the control will be coming back to that very program which was suspended. Then again, the corresponding register save area and current state, past state of the program got suspended will be loaded in the system, and the suspended program will be resumed. So this is the total operation how one interrupt is getting handled. So to depict this particular idea, let me discuss these points. I've written these points point by point. I've mentioned them. CPU interrupt request line triggered by the IO device. So that is the point number 1. So the device is finished its read write operation. What about the story? So now the device is creating one interrupt, is giving interrupt to the interrupt controller. Always remember, interrupt handler is a software, interrupt controller is a respective hardware. So this particular signal is going to this particular interrupt controller. Then step number 2. So it was my step number 1. So step number 2 is this one. So interrupt controller will issue an interrupt to the CPU to indicate that now it is time to get the attention from the CPU. And the CPU will act, will initiate the process against the respective interrupt generated. So that is the flow. Okay, interrupt handler receives the interrupt. Okay, determines the best course of action. Interrupt handler means the respective program. So that program will get the control and it knows that what is to be done against that particular interrupt to provide the required service. Find out the resource of interrupt generation. That means at first I should have to know that for what purpose this interrupt has got generated. An interrupt has come from the disk for what purpose? Any kind of error has taken place? Has it completed the data read or write operation? What is the purpose? Analysis is status. So also I should know the purpose and status of the interrupt. Restarts it when appropriate with the next operation. So after coming back, the next operation which was postponed will be restarted or resumed, and returns control to the interrupted process. So the process will get the control after serving this interrupt, and the interrupted process will be resumed. So these are the best course of actions, and it will take place in this way. So find out the source of the interrupt generation. Who has generated this interrupt? Analyze its status. For what purpose this interrupt has got generated? Restarts it when appropriate with the next operation. So now please execute the required program which will provide the service to the interrupt source, and then returns control to the interrupted process. The process which was interrupted and is now remaining in the suspended state. So that process will be initiated next one. So that process will not be restarted, but the process will be resumed. Okay. Maskable to ignore or delay some interrupts. Interrupts can be handled in two different, can be of two types. So one is a maskable interrupt, another one is a non-maskable interrupt. Non-maskable interrupt means when the interrupt will get produced, then the system is bound to pay attention to that particular interrupt because it cannot be ignored because it is a non-maskable interrupt. But if the interrupt is maskable, then if the interrupt has been masked by the system, then the origination of the interrupt will remain transparent to the CPU. Interrupt vector to dispatch the interrupt to the correct handler. So interrupt vector table is having some jump or go to instruction, and which will be pointing to different interrupt handler routines, and these routines are having the last instruction rate or return which will transfer the control to that particular suspended process. So from the interrupt vector table, I shall get that very starting address of that interrupt handler routine which is supposed to be executed to give the service of this interrupt source. Okay, so interrupt mechanisms are also used for exceptions. If there is some exception has taken place in the system, exception means some erroneous condition has taken place in the system, then also that situation can be handled by this interrupt. So performance overhead, if interrupt occurs, then what are the overheads the system will have to bear? The first one, the cost of storing and restoring the process state, because the process is getting suspended. Now the process execution is now getting blocked. So its current state, the register save area, that means what are the data they have got scattered on the different CPU registers. Each and everything has to be saved in some zone so that next time when the process will be resumed, the process will get enough information so that it can resume very smoothly. So this type of thing, that is a storing and restoring process states, is a very huge overhead to the system. Cost of flushing the interrupt pipeline. So now when the process will get interrupt handler will get executed and its execution has got completed, then I should do the flushing and I should resume the operation of the interrupted process. Restoring the instructions into the pipeline when the process is restarted. So I told you that again the pipeline has to be flushed which was occupied with the different codes of the interrupt handler, and again the pipeline has to be initiated and has to be loaded with the required code of the suspended process so that it can resume. And this is a very interesting diagram, that is the interrupt driven IO cycle, and I have written this one in 6 different steps. So first one, the device driver initiates IO. CPU executing checks for interrupt between instructions. Always remember, until and unless the one instruction which is currently in execution has got not finished, the CPU will not check any presence of interrupt. That means the interrupt which has been generated should remain active until the end of the instruction, otherwise it will not get service. So CPU receives, so that is the first step. Now 2, initializes IO, and then 3, interrupt input ready, output complete or error generates. So that is the source, that is the source of the interrupt. Input ready, output has been completed, one error has got generated in the system. So CPU receiving interrupt transfers control to the interrupt handler through IVT, interrupt vector table. Interrupt handler processes data returns from the interrupt. So whatever the data has been passed from that very particular interrupt source, so that data will be handled by the interrupt handler. I told you that interrupt controller is the hardware, interrupt handler is the software, a program module. CPU resumes processing of interrupted task. So obviously whatever I told, it has been written in this particular flowchart. So in this way, I have completed this particular input-output section on this particular interrupt. Please watch the next videos where you will be discussing other aspects of input-output. Thanks for watching this particular video.